Hi class, today we're going to be talking about complex numbers. Complex numbers are numbers which have two parts to them. They have a real number part, which we're going to call A here, and then they also have what's called an imaginary part, where you have some number, we're going to call it B in this case, being multiplied by what's called an imaginary number, I. And we need to define what I is so you know what I is. In the past, we haven't been able to do the square root of a negative number. But now we are going to go ahead and define the square root of negative 1 as the number I. And so that I that is square root of negative 1 is what we have here for this value right here, that is I in the A plus BI. So a complex number might look like 3 plus 4i, or it might look like 5 minus 2i, or something like that. So that's what they're going to look like. When you're doing basic operations like adding or subtracting, you deal with them the exact same way that you would deal with things that had an x in them instead of an I. So for instance, if we were going to add 3 plus 4i, which is a complex number, to the complex number 5 minus 2i, all you would do is combine like terms. So 3 plus 5 gives you 8, and then 4i plus a negative 2i gives you 2i. So that would be your solution. The same thing happens when you're subtracting these. So let's say that you have a complex number like 3 plus 8i, and you are subtracting from that 4 minus 5i. When we did things like this and had an x instead of an I, the first thing we did was we distributed our subtraction. That's the same thing you'll do here. So we take and distribute our subtraction, turn it into a plus, and change all the signs of everything in the parentheses following it. Now we combine like terms. So 3 and negative 4 makes negative 1, and the 8i plus the 5i makes a 13i, and that would be your answer to adding those. So the basic operations of adding and subtracting will seem exactly the same as what you are used to with x's. Now, before we get into multiplying or dividing these, we need to take a look at what being able to define the square root of negative 1 as the number I allows us to do with simplifying our radicals. So, let's take a look at something that we used to not be able to do. For instance, what about square root of negative 49? In the past, we would say that that is not a real number. And we were right, it was not a real number. It's actually an imaginary number. So, what we are going to do now is take and simplify this into an imaginary number. We're going to recognize that 49 is the same thing as 49 times negative 1. So we can separate this into the square root of 49 times the square root of negative 1. And the square root of 49 is 7. We just defined this square root of negative 1 as I. So when we're asked to do the square root of negative 49, we're going to say that it is this 7i that we have here. Basically, what that means is you could just square root the 49 like we normally would and turn it into this 7. And when you see the negative in there, you just pull an I out and add it to your solution. So if we have square root of negative 81, the negative is going to make an I, and square root of 81 is 9. So it's 9i. What if you had square root of negative 108? For this, since 108 is not a perfect square, we'd look for the largest perfect square that would go into 108, and 36 does. So what I would suggest doing is actually separating this into the square root of a negative 36 times the square root of 3, since 36 times 3 is 108. From what we just did up in these other two examples, The square root of negative 36 is 6i, and we can't simplify the square root of 3, so this is how we would leave our answer for this particular problem. Now, what about some other interesting things that we could create? We said that square root of negative 1 is I. Let's examine what happens when you raise I to different powers. If I square both sides of this equation, notice that what is going to happen is over here the square and the square root cancel and you get negative 1. But over here when I square this, I get I squared. So what we've just done is shown that the I squared is the same thing as negative 1. Now, as we're doing this, we're going to notice something really cool. We're going to keep track of the powers of I over here. So we start with I to the first, which is the same thing as square root of negative 1. And then I squared is negative 1. Now let's look at what about I cubed and see if we can define that. Well, over here, let's look at it. I cubed is the same thing as I squared times I. And we just defined this I squared as negative 1. So let's replace it with negative 1. That gives us negative 1 times I. And when you multiply negative 1 times I, you get negative I. So what we just showed was that the I cubed is the same thing as negative I. So let's keep track of this over here. What about I to the fourth? Well, let's examine that over here just like we did the other two. I to the fourth is the same thing as I squared times I squared. Well, didn't we over here say that I squared was the same thing as negative 1? So let's replace both of those with negative 1. Well, negative 1 times negative 1 is 1. So we just showed that I to the fourth is 1. Now, what about I to the fifth? Isn't I to the fifth the same thing as I to the fourth times I? Well, we just showed that I to the fourth is 1. And 1 times I is I. So I to the fifth is the same thing as I. Notice, there's a pattern here. We have I, then I squared is negative 1, then we go to negative I, then we go to 1, and then we're back at I. Let's keep going so you can notice the rest of the pattern. What about I to the sixth? Well, isn't I to the sixth the same thing as I to the fourth times I squared? And I to the fourth, we showed over here, it is 1. And I squared is negative 1. So let's replace those with that. The I to the fourth is 1, and the I squared is negative 1. So what we get is negative 1. So I to the sixth is negative 1. What happens is this pattern repeats every 4 items. So if you know the first 4 here, that it goes I, negative 1, negative I, 1, you know all of them. Because if we keep going, this I to the 7th is going to be the next one in the pattern. The next one in the pattern after negative 1 goes to negative I. So this right here is going to be negative I. And if we go to I to the 8th, that's going to be the next one, and after your negative I comes 1. Now, there's a way to realize what this is so that if you know the first four, you know I to any power that exists. The way you can deal with this is if you look at the remainder, since it repeats every four, if you look at the remainder when you divide by four, and notice if I divide by four, four by four, I get a remainder of zero and I'm at one. So what you can think of is having an I to the zero, which anything that's not zero raised to the zero power is one. And then you have I to the first, which if you divide 1 by 4, it doesn't go in at all, but there's a remainder of 1, then you get I. If you divide something by 4 and you get a remainder of 2, you'd have the same thing as I squared, which is negative 1. And if you divide something by 4 and you get 3 as a remainder, you would get the same thing as I cubed, which is negative I. And the pattern will repeat itself over and over. If I continue going to 4, 4 divided by 4 is a remainder of 0, so I'm right back up here with the number 1. And so it's just 1i, negative 1, negative I. Now, how will this help us? What if you have a problem where you're supposed to simplify something like I to the 50th? Well, you don't want to take 50 and somehow break it into a bunch of I's, because that would take a really long time. You could actually just take 50 divided by 4 with old-fashioned division and say, okay, 4 goes into that 12 times, and 12 times 4 is 48. Well, there's a remainder of 2. So if I go up here to I squared is negative 1. So the answer to this is negative 1. It works every single time. So what about, instead of that one, we have something like I to the 21. Well, 4 goes into 21 5 times with a remainder of 1. So the one that has a remainder of 1 would be this one, and its answer is I. So the answer to this is I, because if you take 4 and you divide it into 21, 4 goes into 21 5 times, and your remainder is 1. Well, that takes you up here to this one, and that gives you your answer. Every single time it works. Now, that's how you would simplify I to any power. When you're multiplying or dividing radicals, the one that you're going to use the most is I squared, knowing that I squared is negative 1.